Todd, there seems to be this belief that once we address the public health issues and the pandemic is contained, that we're going to go back to an economic normal, whatever that may look like. And there have been all kinds of speculations, I'm sure you've heard, with respect to what that recovery might look like. Is it a U shape? Is it a V shape? Is it perhaps even a W shape? Or are we, you know, getting ready to hit a second round of this? What are the biggest headwinds that are facing us?
You know, in our McKinsey's economic update for May, we talk about exactly these issues. And we focus on the fact that we're currently in the most severe economic contraction since the Great Depression, in what the International Monetary Fund is calling the Great Lockdown. And, you know, the employment statistics really bear that out. If you look at Canada, we've seen 3 million job losses in March and April, which has taken our unemployment rate from a near record low to double digits, to 13%, with similar type of numbers in the U.S., 33 million lost jobs since the low point in the crisis, and now double-digit unemployment rates at 14.7%. So economic growth looks like it's going to fall by about 6% in both Canada and the U.S.
You do mention job losses, and we've seen job losses to the tune of millions on both sides of the divide in the U.S. and in Canada. And in spite of economic contraction, we've seen the markets rally. What do you chalk that up to?
Yeah, it's really interesting to see the stock markets really in stark contradiction to what we're seeing with the severe economic contraction. Global stock markets have rebounded 25 to 30% since the low point in March. And I believe investor optimism really reflects three key factors. The first is that we're seeing tentative signs of a peak in the number of new cases and deaths in major markets from the pandemic. Second, more and more jurisdictions are talking about reopening their economies to end the sudden stop in a large share of the global economy. And third, and very importantly, government programs and central bank policies have really moved quickly in unprecedented scale and scope to try to underpin demand in the economy and prevent business bankruptcies from otherwise viable businesses that are just facing a severe cash crunch, and to ensure a steady flow of credit. I think importantly, there's two other factors as well. One is that the two key fundamental building blocks for the long-term fair value of stock markets are interest rates and corporate earnings growth. And the consensus sees corporate earnings naturally dropping sharply this year, but rebounding in 2021. Likewise, interest rates are expected to stay lower for longer. And these two factors are pushing up the long-term fair value for equities.
I'm curious to get your take on corporate earnings that were released for Q1. Were they as bad as you thought they were? Were they not as bad as you thought they were? Is Q2 going to be a more realistic snapshot of what's really happening? Your take, Todd.
Yeah, thank you. So I think that we've seen some pretty severe earnings growth numbers, and I think that likely to persist into the second quarter. Corporate earnings growth recovers through the remainder of the year is of course very uncertain. It really reflects a number of factors that we still don't know quite yet. So, for example, will we see secondary waves of infection in the virus? Will we see spillover effects from the current lockdown in terms of global events that could become headwinds, like emerging market crises, or even here in North America, could we see spillovers from the current slowdown in the corporate credit markets? So I think we could see a bumpy road in terms of corporate earnings for the remainder of 2020. But the consensus view is to see a slow and steady rebound through 2021.
I don't think anybody would argue that government fiscal policy was much needed during this crisis. In the U.S., that help was about 13% of GDP. In Canada, I believe, according to your report, it was about 8% of GDP. But that now leaves us with pretty hefty deficits. What happens now?
Right. I think that's a great question. As we're seeing in many countries around the world, governments have stepped up with incredible speed and with large-scale programs to bridge lost incomes during the lockdown, and that's resulted in very large budget deficits. As you mentioned, in the U.S., we could see budget the pandemic relief itself is north of 10% of GDP, and in Canada, it's 8.5% of GDP, which will spill over into much larger budget deficits. In the U.S., we could see budget deficits rise from 5.75% of GDP all the way to around 18% of GDP. So these are really enormous deficits that will feed through into higher levels of debt. Now, the key question is, are these higher debt levels sustainable in the long term? And in my view, debt dynamics are still looking pretty sustainable as long as government deficits can come back down in 2021, which seems likely as the lockdowns end and as the economies start a more sustainable recovery path. Also, interest rates are very, very low and are expected to stay low for some years to come while growth rates continue to expand. And that should help bring down these very high government debt ratios back to more sustainable levels over a period of time.
When you take a look at that horizon, pre-coronavirus, Canada's energy sector was suffering. Business investment sentiment in Canada was suffering. How does Canada recover? Do we see a recovery in our energy sector? Do we see that business investment sentiment increase in the long run?
Yeah, these are important questions. Canada's been hit on a number of fronts. Not only are we dealing with the pandemic-related economic slowdown from the lockdown, but also we have the twin crisis of dramatically lower oil prices compared to a year ago, as well as localized energy sectors in Canada around pipeline transportation and so on. Because of this, business investment will be a key factor going forward. Two of the key ingredients are both: how will businesses respond? Will they respond? Will we see business investment return to pre-pandemic trends? And also in the household sector, will we see households return to pre-pandemic spending levels, or will they retrench as well and increase their precautionary savings? For an investor, I think the key bottom line is that now more than ever, diversification across different asset classes and different geographies is extremely important. This pandemic and the extremely unprecedented and very uncertain in terms of how it will unfold. And we don't know where the next shoe will drop. So having a very diversified and resilient portfolio across different possible risk factors is important. And here in Canada, we have a fairly concentrated stock market in the commodity and financial sector. So looking for greater diversification can be really important to try to safeguard your portfolio from these kinds of issues.
As you look to Q2, what is some of the key data that you're looking at? Is it unemployment? Is it fiscal policy? Is it monetary policy? What are these trigger points that you're looking for?
So in the second quarter, we'll be looking at a number of things. One of the important trends I want to keep an eye on in the coming months will be inflation. Now, we're in the middle of an extremely sharp economic contraction with strong deflationary forces at work. We see that in terms of the actual inflation numbers, the reports coming out. We also see that in terms of what markets have priced in inflation-linked bonds. But once the economic recovery starts taking hold, once we have a final resolution to this public healthcare crisis, once we get into that recovery path, we need to keep a close eye on inflation trends. The reason being is the market has priced in very low levels of inflation, but at the same time, we see a large increase in government debt, very low central bank interest rates, and central bank lending facilities that are effectively printing money, and that money could leak into the real economy to finance this increase in demand. So while now it's certainly not an issue, and if anything, we're still dealing with the crisis, and all these programs are very well justified and important, but in the longer run, second quarter, third quarter, as we get into the recovery phase, it's going to be very important to keep an eye on inflation trends.